evening and welcome to the Cook County Bar Association's Live on Can TV. I am your host, Mika Thompson, and today we have my esteemed colleague and former board member and president of the Cook County Bar Association, Lewis Powell III, and he will be speaking about real estate. And he is a professor of law and a long-term practitioner in the courtroom, hands-on attorney. So we have an opportunity to get some very concrete, useful information. So please tune in and call with your questions at 312-738-1060. That's 312-738-1060. This is the Cook County Bar Association, and we are the oldest association of African American lawyers and judges in the country. And we take this time on Monday nights to have this conversation with you, the viewing public, about legal issues and breaking stories that pertain to legislation. So I'm going to turn it over to my esteemed colleague, Attorney Powell. How are you today?
I'm fine, and thank you for that very, very generous introduction. I appreciate it.
Always, always. Okay, so real estate. Is there anything you'd like to tell the viewing public about your background, Attorney Powell?
No, we're gonna get into this topic.
Okay.
Let me say this. The main thing, ladies and gentlemen, is this. They're not making no more land.
Right.
Let me repeat that.
Right.
They are not making any more land. Land is a very valuable commodity. It's something, real estate is not all that complex. Mm-hmm. And my theory is if you keep at it long enough, eventually you'll have some success.
That's right. And so in this segment about real estate, because we do speak about this topic often, we want to focus on the process, the home buying process, and just give you some basic tips if you're out here in the marketplace.
All right.
Okay, take it away.
Great. Well, what's the first step in home buying?
Yes, what is
okay,
the first step?
For years, I was a real estate broker. I got my salesperson license in 1985, actually.
Okay.
84. I got my broker's license in 1990. So I have experience in terms of being a real estate broker and as an attorney. I practiced law 27 years, approached my 28th anniversary. Time flies. But in any event, the first thing, ladies and gentlemen, is that you want to get you a good real estate broker.
Yes.
All real estate professionals now, brokers, there was a time period when I started years ago that you had the salesperson and you had the brokers. For all practical purpose, the salesperson terminology, the salesperson title has now been eliminated. Everyone is a real estate broker. A real estate broker may be an owner, manager. A real estate broker may be a manager of the office, so forth and so on. But ladies and gentlemen, the first thing that you need to do when you're serious about buying some real estate is to get you a good real estate broker.
And can you talk about just a little bit about the difference between the broker and the real estate in terms of one of the reasons why they did that, isn't it? Because so that they would have more liability, you know, with us?
You know, Mika, that's a good question. I'm not sure.
Okay.
Because the reality of it is they're still operating in the same function, which we're going to get into.
Right.
You have the listing agent or the listing real estate broker. The listing agent's responsibility is to list the property,
right,
to market the property. Ladies and gentlemen, we have what is called the MLS. Okay, if the property is on MLS.
Oh, wait a minute, I'm sorry. It looks like we have a caller. Caller, you're on the air. What is your question?
Good evening. You sort of made a good introduction. You were talking about MOS. I want to talk about SOL. If you don't pay your I'm talking about one of the biggest rackets there is property tax redemption. Now, if you don't pay your property taxes like you should, how they could pile up in terms of penalties and interest, and how the county let somebody come in and redeem your taxes. Because if you don't pay, you're talking about in terms of attorney fees and court fees, how something like $700 could roll up to easy $8,000, and that's one of the biggest rackets there is. Could you please comment, attorney, about paying your property taxes and making sure you're paying your property taxes right and how those things get out of hand?
Absolutely. First thing, you have due warning. people pay their property taxes late all the time.
Okay.
Now, what you have to pay attention to is, first, you'll get a warning letter saying that if you don't pay your property taxes by X amount of date, then it'll be eligible for the tax sale.
Oh, okay.
Okay? Now, if you don't pay your taxes before the tax sale, and unfortunately someone buys your taxes, then that sets them up to eventually get your property. But again, you get notice. Usually, most people are going to pay their taxes eventually. If you don't pay your taxes on time, again, you have time to pay it before it becomes eligible on the tax sale. If someone buys your property on a tax sale, you still have you have opportunity to pay the taxes, and as you say, you're going to pay some penalties toward that.
And it can be expensive, can it?
It adds up, but it's not going to kill you,
okay?
Because
okay?
Depending upon what it is, but it's a substantial commercial property, it could be costly.
Okay.
Okay? Now, if you don't pay it on time, it goes to the tax sale, somebody buys your property, then you're going to get notice sooner or later saying that you have X amount of time to redeem your taxes.
Right.
Again, you're getting warning. Now, as the gentleman said, it's adding up. Okay, you have to pay back the outstanding taxes that you owe the county, plus penalty, and here's how the money is made. The tax buyer, that's why it's a win-win situation. When somebody buys your property for taxes, they really can't lose. Because if you redeem the property, they get their money back that they paid for the taxes, plus a substantial amount of interest.
Mm-hmm.
If you go down to the county building, you see people constantly going through the tax records, seeing what properties they can go after.
Yeah.
The tax buyer's theory is, I'm not trying to get property in terms of getting a hold of it. I'm going to make my money off of the interest. And if somebody messes up, I get the property.
Mm-hmm.
And if they mess up, I get the property eventually. Then I put it on the market and sell it
okay. For
whatever they can get. It's still a profit because they've gotten it for less than what it's been, nine times out of ten, what is owed.
Can you also ask, I've always wondered, so since he asked that question, can anybody become a tax buyer?
Absolutely.
Okay.
To the best of my knowledge, anybody can buy your taxes. I'm not sure if there's an age limit, to be honest with you.
Okay.
So for all practical purposes, anybody can pay for your taxes.
Got you. So it's just that they can go at that tax sale and just, is there a registration process or is just you just go and...
I believe you have to register, but I'm not quite sure of that because I've never bought taxes by another process. But anybody can.
Okay. All right. That was a very interesting question. Good. Okay. Going on to our next question is, how long does it take to buy a home, Attorney Powell?
That's an iffy question because it depends upon you and the real estate broker. The real estate broker has access to the MLS. The MLS will give you information on the properties that you describe to the realtor that you want in terms of description of the type of property that you want. Also, a description in terms of geographically where you want to live.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this is a fair housing point as well. The realtor is supposed to show you where you would like to buy.
Right.
The real estate broker.
Oh, we got another caller. Okay, caller, you're on the air. What is your question?
Yes, sir, young lady. I'm a 70-year-old man. And it's taking this long for to get more black judges, more Hispanic judges to help us get the more real estate for us to be able to buy it. And it seems to me that nothing ever changes, even with electing more black and Hispanic judges. What did we do? I'm asking the gentleman now, what can we do to make sure that we're included in everything, because right now we're not. Thank you.
What do you mean everything?
I'm talking about having a fair chance to get real estate. Well, we're not, because I own my own home and stuff. I'm a 70-year-old Vietnam vet. I did on my own. I didn't need any judges. I didn't need any real estate people. But there are people that need people. Real estate people to help them.
Okay.
Thank you for your call.
I like to answer the question.
Okay.
Okay, it's a little bit off topic, but I'm going to try to bring it on topic.
Okay.
Real estate is wide open. Real estate is fundamentally simple. If you get a real estate broker that can show you the type of properties and the areas that you desire, and you have the proper training in terms of, we're not just talking about residential property,
right.
We're talking about multifamily property.
Right.
There are plenty of training programs out there that will teach you once you become a landlord, because Mika, it's not what you make, it's what you keep.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, you need to be cognizant of the, we already talked about the property taxes. You need to be aware of energy conservation. You need to have your building energy efficient.
Mm-hmm.
Okay,
sure.
You need to have a proper evaluation of your tenant. You don't want to rent a unit to somebody that, at least on paper, cannot pay for your unit.
Now that is a very point.
So there's several factors that come into landlord property management that there are plenty of programs out there that you can take online. I recommend going in person so you can ask questions. But real estate is wide open. Real estate is still open to minorities. It is a wide open field.
And what about community colleges with regards
community
to?
Colleges, the same thing. There are plenty of community colleges that offer basic property management classes. You just go online and let your fingers digitally do the walk.
And they may not be that expensive. You're
They're
talking
not.
About a basic class that maybe 6 weeks or something like
Less
that?
Less than 6 weeks.
Wow.
In
okay.
fact, I don't want to promote anything, but I participate with a particular program where we talk about fair housing, and from time to time we talk about eviction, so forth and so on.
Right.
And that program is at a nominal cost. But trust me, if you just do some due diligence on the webs on the internet, you will find plenty of programs to train you.
Okay. So it's really about education.
It's
really
about education.
Getting the information out there.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that's great. Okay, well, thank you. My next question is, what is a seller's market?
Well, a seller's market is a market where there are more buyers than houses that are for sale.
Okay.
That's the basic definition. And when it's a seller's market, that is, it is good for the seller because people are competing to buy their property. There's some areas in the city, Chicago metropolitan area, that are so hot that as soon as the property is listed, that you may have multiple offers on it. Also, there's some areas in the city of Chicago, metropolitan area, that are so hot that people may offer more than what the price is listed.
Right. So in those situations, it may take a little more extra money to have, and you really would have to have it available and ready to move on.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Caveat, cash is king.
Right.
Always remember, most people will take a lesser cash offer than an offer with a mortgage. Why? Because 9 times out of 10, there are some exceptions, cash is quicker in terms of closing.
Okay. All right. And then what is a buyer's market?
A buyer's market, elementary, a definition. A buyer's market is when there are more homes for sale than there are buyers.
Right.
That's the fundamental definition. Reader's Digest version. This is a market where a buyer can take advantage of sellers that are desperate to sell. Sellers that may have property that have been on the market for a long time, they haven't gotten any bites, they may wish to, go into retirement, they may wish to downscale, so forth and so on. There are a number of factors that will make it a buyer's market, and the bottom line is when there are more houses up for sale than there are buyers.
So right now, what would you consider the marketplace?
I think right now it's kind of even Steven.
Okay.
This is real estate is coming back. Now I'm not quite sure that we're going to see what we saw back in the 90s.
Okay.
And maybe for a lot of reasons, it's probably good.
Okay.
Because the 90s were like the wild, wild west
yes,
of real estate.
That's true.
A lot of fraud going on, people getting mortgages that had absolutely no business getting mortgaged, a lot of unnecessary foreclosures, so forth and so on.
Okay. All right. We are the Cook County Bar Association. The number to call is 312-738-1060. We are the oldest association of African American judges and lawyers in the country, and we are here with Attorney Powell, who is giving us information about real estate and how to buy. Okay, getting back to our discussion, what is a stratified market?
You know what? That I don't know.
Okay.
I'm going to do some research on that.
Okay. Okay, how much do you have to pay to have an agent to help you buy a house?
Usually, almost 9.9, you don't have to pay for your agent. Usually, under the typical transaction, the real estate broker, you have the listing broker, and you have the agent that's showing the property. The agent is showing the property, theoretically is representing the buyer, but under the laws of agency, technically everybody's representing the seller. A lot of people don't realize that. Usually the broker's or sell the broker's compensation is going to come from the proceeds of the sale. With exception, there are times, especially in a hot market, where a buyer may pay the broker, a real estate broker, to act as their sole agent.
Okay.
And that happens from time to time, especially when there's a hot market, that the buyer is at the property that he knows is going to be competitive to get it, that he may be willing to pay his realtor a certain fee to act in his behalf, to search out properties, to negotiate in his behalf to buy property.
Okay, that's interesting. Because normally it's dual, right?
Normally it's dual. That's what I alluded to.
Right.
Because technically they're both really agents of the seller under normal circumstance, right, to a certain extent.
Okay. All right. And then what kind of credit score do you have to have?
That's a hard question.
Okay.
Now, caveat, don't give up. If your credit is not credit worthy, there are some things that can be done on that. You know, there's some credit repair agencies. Also, it's the old-fashioned way of just buckling down and paying your bills. Mm-hmm. Now, this is a fair housing question as well. Mortgage persons, they can help you to a certain extent.
Mm-hmm.
Say, for example, you've been paying your bills regularly, but you had a blip in the road, which can right. happen to the best of us. The mortgage broker or the mortgage person can assist you in doing what's called a letter of explanation.
Right.
A letter of explanation will state why at this particular period in time there were late fees. Well, there could have been a number of factors. You could have been sick. Your mother could have been sick. Your significant other could have been sick, which caused a drain in your resources in terms of a hospital bill, so forth and so on, and perhaps missing work and missing wages, so forth and so on. Sometimes, not emphasize sometimes, because it's certainly not all the times, that you may present a letter of clarification or a letter of explanation as to why your credit in terms of slow payments or no payments at all. So that's a hard question. That's a question really for a mortgage professional to say what the average acceptable credit score is.
Okay.
So again, there's always exceptions to that.
So how much do you need to pay as far as the down payment?
That's okay. The typical real estate transaction, usually you can get by if it's owner occupied with 5% down, okay? Mm-hmm. Not counting the miscellaneous closing costs, but 5% down of the purchase price. Now, general rule of thumb, if you put down 20%, if you have 20%, it actually is better for you because lenders make money on you the longer you take to pay.
Mm-hmm.
The and more
so
they
by,
make.
So by but putting the 20% down, then you're reducing the overall.
Right, exactly. But most people on a typical real estate transaction, owner-occupied, mm-hmm. is usually 5% down. The typical transaction in terms of non-owner occupied, i.e. a multifamily building, an apartment building, usually general rule of thumb, unless you are actually occupying the property, you have to put down 20% down. Again, not including miscellaneous closing costs.
Okay. And, could you explain to the audience what closing costs are?
Okay, closing costs are title costs. Okay, you have to have title insurance. Nobody in their right mind is going to buy property from you without a title policy, because the title policy basically guarantees the quality of the title. What are we talking about? Making sure there are no liens on the property, no back taxes owed. The title commitment, if there's something out there on you personally, 9 times out of 10 it's going to come out. If you haven't paid your taxes and there's a lien on you personally, it's going to probably pop up on the buyer's side. But Reader's Digest version, title costs, closing at the title company, usually when you close at the title company, unless it's a cash deal, closing at the title company is usually a sole price bared by the buyer. However, if it's a cash deal, customarily in the Chicago area, closing at the title company in terms of using their facilities is split. Okay, other miscellaneous closing costs. On the sales side, you have what is called transfer stamps. In the city of Chicago, on the seller side, you would pay a certain percentage toward the county and the state. You on the buyer's, on the seller side. The Chicago stamps are uneven split between the seller and the buyer. So that's just a Reader's Digest version of the various miscellaneous costs when we say closing costs.
And those come off the purchase price, off the top of the purchase
that
price.
That comes out what you need to bring to the table.
So that doesn't, it doesn't come out of the
not necessarily.
Okay. Or maybe some of those things can be negotiated with.
Not really. To a certain extent, some title companies, if they want your business, they may come down off the title insurance.
Okay.
Non-negotiable in terms of the transfer tax.
I'm sure all the taxes, you know. So, okay. Okay. Well, thank you about that. So, how many homes should I view before picking settling on one?
Now, the realtor's going to say hopefully one. I'm just joking. But the realtors in the business are making money. They want to show you, based upon your description and where you want to live and style a home and your pocketbook, because as I like to say, the realtor's not obligated to show you a home for $500,000 that's on the market, and they know, because most realtors are going to pre-qualify you. Mm-hmm. And most realtors may even send you to a mortgage person, they do business on a regular basis, to run a check based on information that you provided to get a feel for what you can afford. Mm-hmm. So nobody's going to, they're not obligated to show you a house for $500 knowing that you can't pay for it.
Right.
So the answer to that's on a case-by-case basis. You need to reserve as many houses as you can possibly reserve within a reasonable period of time based upon your style and your pocketbook.
Okay. All right. One last question. What is earnest money?
Earnest money is good faith money. A lot of times, unfortunately, as lawyers, you are trained, if you represent the seller, to try to get as much earnest money as you can. Why? Because of the buyer, because people are fickle. If the buyer changes his mind for no legal basis, you can keep that earnest money. Now, a lot of times people try to get by with $1,000 earnest money. Now, $1,000 is not a lot of money. No. It's a lot of money to me. But $1,000, the average person may just say, well, you know what? I'm going to take a chance and just walk. You keep my $1,000, and I'm just going to go about my business and take a chance. You're not going to sue me, which most people are not going to sue on a typical regular residential transaction. However, on a commercial unit that's worth substantial sums of money, you try to get as much earnest money as you can, because if they walk, because they got fickle or cold feet, you want to snatch that earnest money. And so earnest money is, in layman's term, is good faith money that you intend to purchase the property and not walk away during the process.
Well, thank you, Attorney Piles. This has been a wonderful conversation with regards to real estate, and I hope our viewing public enjoyed our conversation and got something out of it. Again, my name is Mika Thompson. I am an attorney and I am a member of the Cook County Bar Association, along with my colleague, Lewis Powell. We hope you enjoyed our show today, and we hope that you will tune in next week when we will be talking about legislative issues regarding the Health Care Act. Thank you again for tuning in. My name is Mika Thompson, and good night.